Hello and welcome to the Power BI Desktop February 2020 update. In this video, we do a rundown of what's included in this month's release, and we'll also have the product team demo some of the highlights. So let's get started. First, in the dataset management section, we're excited to announce that Incremental Refresh is now generally available, meaning it's no longer a premium-only feature, but now also supported in Power BI Pro. Now I'll hand it off to Christian for a demo of the feature.
Hello everyone, this is Christian Wade, and I'm very happy to let you know that Incremental Refresh is now generally available, and backed by popular demand, it is now supported with Power BI Pro. Incremental Refresh allows you to optimize your refreshes so that you don't need to refresh all of the historical data every time you do a refresh. This makes your refreshes much faster and much more reliable. What you can do is define an incremental refresh policy in Power BI Desktop to, for example, refresh the last 5 years when you first invoke a refresh after publishing the data set for the first time, and subsequent refreshes will refresh only the last 10 days in this example. You can also use advanced features like detect data changes to refresh only the periods that actually have data that changed, which again is much more efficient than refreshing the full data set. Now, in conjunction with the large models feature, this allows you, or incremental refresh allows you, to unlock really large data sets. So this particular data set is about 1.8 terabytes in its raw uncompressed form. This is about 70 gigabytes in its compressed form. And this would be impossible to create without the incremental refresh feature in conjunction with large models. So here I have New York taxi rides across a 10-year period. Each row in the trip table represents an individual New York taxi ride. This trip count measure gives us the count of the rows in the table. Lo and behold, this is over 3 billion rows. And I can just create visuals very, very easily, very, very fast. Here I've got the top 10 pickup locations by zip code. And we can, of course, visualize this on a map, as this is Power BI. So let's go ahead and create a nice little visual here. And there we go. And again, this would not be possible without the incremental refresh feature. Now, to set this up in Power BI Desktop, I can define the incremental refresh policy, as we already discussed. And I also need to set up some Power Query parameters. So this is going to ensure that the data here in Power BI Desktop is nice and small, that I can upload it comfortably to the service. And when I invoke a refresh, it will then grow to many years worth of data, right? So to go ahead and publish it to the service, so I can click on publish, and I can publish to workspaces that are not necessarily on Power BI Premium capacities anymore. It now works on Power BI Pro. Thank you very much.
Moving on to our reporting section. Our first update in this section is the built-in slicer now supports hierarchies. Now let's see a demo from Will.
The hierarchy slicer is a visual that we've wanted to work on for some time, mostly because it was something that was coming from many, many customer requests. We had over 1,600 votes on our ideas forum, as you can see. There was actually a custom visual available that provided some of this capability, but we wanted to make sure it was available as a core visual as well, so that you could use it out of the box, and it would work with all types and ranges of data that people are using within Power BI. So this feature you'll see is a preview feature, so you need to turn it on through the options dialog. But once you do so, anytime you add a slicer to a page, you will find that you can now add multiple fields into that slicer. So if I was to do something like adding our class, it would act just like a regular slicer. But as soon as I add a second field like color name, you can see now that my slicer has these chevrons to let me expand and collapse to navigate up and down through this hierarchy. So I can build a hierarchy just by dragging any number of fields that I want to onto here. So I could even add, you know, product name in as well. And I can reorder them like I can do with fields in any visual to change the order in which they appear in the hierarchy. So if I expand out through economy, pick one of these colors, you'll see some of the specific products that are underneath there. And at this point, the selection model works just like any other slicer. So when I left click on one of these, it's going to filter down the other visuals on my page to just that thing that I've selected. Just left clicking between them toggles the item that I've got selected. I can hold down Control and select the item as well, and that'll add things to the selection to show you multiple options. I can select items at different levels in the hierarchy as well. So this is now showing me all of the blue products. And if I expand that out, you'll see here's all those ones that are selected underneath. Control clicking in this case is going to deselect items, so it's showing all blue products apart from these two AdventureWorks desk lamps. I can even make selections at different levels of the hierarchy. So I could say I want to see all of the gold products and just these two green products. There's a number of formatting options that are available for the hierarchy slicer. So over in the formatting pane, as with the regular slicer, you'll see things like being able to turn on single select mode, which flips the slicer over into this kind of radio icon look and feel. I also wanted to point out that you can add fields from multiple tables. So for example, if I go to my product categories table, let's just go back to product name. I can bring in the product category and subcategory fields and drill down through a hierarchy across those different tables as well. There are some limitations on the types of relationships that you can use when you're working with fields across tables. For example, many-to-many relationships aren't supported. And there's details and examples on what you can and can't work with in the documentation. If your model includes hierarchies, for example, this date hierarchy, adding that to the slicer will automatically put it into the hierarchy mode so that you can expand and collapse through years, quarters, months, and the individual days. If you'd rather have the date range picker, just selecting the date field itself and dragging that onto the field well will put it into the mode where you can drag to select a date range or use the built-in date picker. If you want to swap it over, just add the date hierarchy and remove the date field and you'll get the hierarchy nature instead. You can also swap between a list and a drop-down slicer, the different sort of modes that you'd expect from the existing slicer, you can do that here too.
We also have some updates to the new ribbon, which is in preview. These updates include the new look for the title bar, new key tips functionality, the ability to set custom format strings from the ribbon, and finally, the title bar, ribbon, and file menu are now fully keyboard accessible. We have Tessa here today who will show you a demo of the updates.
So first, we want to thank you guys all for giving us a lot of feedback on the ribbon. It's been really helpful to hear what has and hasn't been working for you, and it really helps influence the direction we take in the product. With our updates to the ribbon and the title bar, the first thing you may have noticed is that we have a new look for the title bar. You see that there's this dark background. The second thing that you may have noticed is that we have added some controls to the top left of the title bar. So this is more closely aligned with Office, and we heard some feedback from you guys that you wanted the save, undo, and redo button to be put back in the title bar. So we did that for you guys. And hopefully this makes these actions a lot quicker for you to get access to, and they're in a place that is familiar to you. On the right side of the title bar, we also have the sign-in control. So that aligns a little bit more with Office, and this adds to the cohesive look. The next update is that we now have key tip functionality in Power BI's ribbon. So in Office, you might be familiar with the idea that you can use your keyboard to navigate around the ribbon, and we've added that in to help with accessibility. So if I press Alt in Windows, then we'll see that these keyboard key tips show up. If I want to navigate to a different tab in the ribbon, I can press the letter that's associated with the tab that I'm interested in. So if I'm interested in moving to the insert button, I can press the I key. And once I move there, then I see the sub buttons that are available and the key tips that are associated with them. If I want to continue and execute on that specific control, then I can just continue to press my key tips. And let's say I want to add a new visual, I would press NB and a new visual would show up. Every time you want those key tips to show up, you just press Alt in Windows. And if I've navigated to a different tab, so if I navigate to the modeling tab, I can press M, and I decide I actually want to move out of this layer of key tips, then I can press Escape, and that'll move me back out to the tabs in the ribbon. Beyond key tips, the ribbon is now fully accessible. You can navigate around the title bar, ribbon, and file menu using keyboard and accessibility tools. So if I want to move around the ribbon, I can press tab. And in between the different tabs, I can use arrow keys to navigate between the tabs in the ribbon. Now let's say I want to go into a subsection of the tabs, then I can press tab and continue to use my arrow keys to move around these items in my ribbon as well. You may remember from before that the only way that you could set custom format strings was to go to the modeling tab or modeling view in Power BI Desktop, and then go to your properties pane and make sure that you have this format section selected on the custom area. Now you can set custom format strings in the ribbon, and by doing that, I can just click on whatever column or measure that I'm interested in, and I can click in this format combo box here, and if I just paste in the custom format string that I'm interested in, then we'll see now that my field here has been formatted to this new value that I want it to be displayed as. Now in the context of this, since I have month number and I'm using a currency type format, it might not necessarily make sense in this context, but the idea is that you can now change your custom format string in the ribbon as well. And if I go back to the modeling view here, and you see that I've set this custom format string for my account of product. If I've set this custom format string previously in the properties pane, I can still see that propagated through to the ribbon. So if I go back to my report view and I click on my account of product, then you'll see that custom format string is also displayed in the combo box in the ribbon as well.
Next in our modeling section, we have a few updates. We've added two new DAX functions, first non-blank value and last non-blank value. These new functions will return the first or last measure value that is not blank. To further illustrate these new functions, let's see an example from Sujatha.
To demonstrate these two new DAX functions, I'll be using a really simple data set that's based on a order date and has a sum of units for that order date. So the sum of units column will actually have a few blank values to help illustrate this example. So let's say if I'm using the first non-blank value function, you'll notice that there is a similar DAX function called first non-blank, and I'll go ahead and explain the difference between the two. So both of these functions take in the exact same parameters, which is a column and then an expression. So we'll switch to first on blank, column here and expression. However, they're going to evaluate to different results. So let me show you real quick by using a card. So I'm going to drag in first non-blank here. And then let me take another card. And then I'm going to drag in first non-blank value. So you'll notice that basically first non-blank returns not the measure value, but the value of the column that you entered, whereas first on blank value is going to actually compute the value rather than return the value from the column. And this difference is the exact same for last on blank, except instead of looking at the first one, it's going to go ahead and look at the last value instead of the last column value.
Now moving on to our visualization section. We have several new custom visuals now available on AppSource, and we have a couple of updates to existing visuals. First, by xViz, we have funnel and pyramid chart. Then we have OEE Dashboard by 3AG Systems. Next, we have organization chart by MAQ Software. The last new visual this month is the PI VIZpack by PQ Systems, which includes histogram, individuals control chart, individuals and moving range control chart, multi-group individuals chart, X-bar control chart, X-bar and range control chart, P-chart, and U-chart. We have one more update in this section. In December, we announced the new Zebra BI tables and charts custom visuals. Recently, they just announced several new updates to those visuals, so be sure to update to the latest version to take advantage of the new improvements. If you want to learn more about any of these custom visuals and updates, be sure to check down in the description for the download links, as well as links to video demos for these visuals. Next, we have a few new template apps. If you're new to template apps, they're an easy way to build custom apps by starting from pre-built datasets and reports that were carefully curated by our partners. This month's template apps are Microsoft 365 Usage Analytics, NFL Analytics, Actaris for QuickBooks, Xero, and Workflow Max. Be sure to check down in the description if you're interested in trying any of these template apps. Next, we have an update in our data preparation section. Last October, we released the Query Diagnostics feature in preview. And with that initial release, some users of the Microsoft Store version were unable to run diagnostics if they didn't have admin rights. Now this month, for those users, we've added non-admin support for Query Diagnostics when using the Query Editor. Finally, in our data connectivity section, we have several updates. We have a couple of connectors that are now generally available. MicroStrategy connector and FHIR connector are now generally available. We also have several brand new connectors, which include the FactSet connector, TIBCO connector, Jamf Pro connector, Asana connector. That's it for this month. We hope you enjoy the new features and improvements. Please keep sending us feedback and let us know which features you'd like to see in upcoming releases. Also, if you'd like to interact and network with the Power BI team and other Power BI creators, we encourage you to register for the Microsoft Business Application Summit in May. Thanks for watching, and we'll see you again next month.